The vultures were to be disappointed. The four men went to sleep early, as is custom when travelers are hungry or thirsty, and next morning were still alive. So they escaped. Fortunately, they escaped the danger of being preyed or victimized by the vultures because they slept early because of the hunger and thirst they had. They went to sleep early, and this is usually the custom or the tradition or the routine with the people who are traveling in a desert, because being thirsty or hungry, they go to sleep early. They had just enough water left to make one cup of tea each, and then set off for the next water hole about 5 hours distance. They only had the amount of water which was enough to make one cup of tea each, means 4 cups of tea water was available. They had it, and then they moved to the next water hole, the next point from where they could get water, and that was 5 hours distance. When they reached it just before the hottest part of the day, they reached that well before the hottest part, means before noon, right at the noon time, and they found that the well was quite dry. It was quite completely dry. The next water hole was 2 days away. Now the bad luck or the hard luck was that the next point of water, the next well, they knew that was on 2 days distance, so they had to travel 2 days completely, then they could reach that well, the next point of water. But now they didn't have any food, nor had they any water. The future looked grim. Now the future looked serious to him. They felt the danger of being dragged to death because of the hunger and thirst. There was just one chance of survival. Only one thing they, only one chance they could have for making themselves alive. That was that one of the 6 camels could be killed. They had 6 camels, and they could just kill 1 camel. The decision was made. Christopher being asked to pay his share of the cost, to which he willingly agreed. Christopher was asked to pay the cost of the camel being killed, because that wasn't owned by the people present in the caravan, because that camel was given to them by the by the leader of the big caravan. It's fine. Strangely enough, as soon as the camel was picked for the slaughter, it seemed to know what was to happen and started screaming at the top of its voice. When one of the camels was picked, it seems that it felt the purpose of its being brought to them, and it started screaming so loudly. When the victim was killed, the liquid in his stomach was caught in a water bag by the slave. The slave caught, collected the water, the liquid present in the stomach of that camel. He collected it in a water bag. It would be hard to think of a less appetizing drink than the greenish fluid. It was just greenish fluid. It was just less appetizing. It wasn't good to smell. It wasn't good to see at all. It wasn't good to drink at all. Like thin blood. It was just like thin blood produced from this source. Even the Tuaregs made faces as they drank it. They were drinking it while they drank it. They made faces because it was too bad to drink. Christopher could not tackle it. Christopher couldn't even drink it, parched though he was, until he had boiled it, and he was parched with thirst. His mouth was so dry, and he was out of breath because of the thirst. Still, he couldn't eat it until he had boiled it. Finally, he boiled it and then he drank it, and even then he had to hold his nose while he drank it. And when he was drinking it, he had to hold his nose because it was too bad to taste. Somehow he got it down. Anyways, somehow he got it down. He swallowed this water together with the camel's flesh. The unappetizing liquid kept them going for another 2 days. So the unappetizing liquid, that water in the stomach, and that fluid in the stomach, and the flesh of that camel, they they served to make them alive for the coming 2 days. The region though which they were passing was known as the Lord of Thirst and Death, Land of Thirst and Death. So the region where they were passing, that was called Land of Thirst and Death, and the name was well chosen, and the name of that land, that region, was rightly chosen because it was the land of thirst and death. People couldn't usually survive in that area. It was an area notorious for sandstorms as well as for dried up water holes. This area was famous, badly famous for sandstorms, because sandstorms were so frequent in that region of the desert, and whatever water holes, whatever wells it contained, it had, they were all dried up. They were completely dry. They were waterless. Christopher soon experienced one of them. So one of the dangers Christopher had to experience, and shortly after the midday stop on the following day, on the following day when they had a stop at the mid time of day, the camels all instinctively turned off their course to the right, making for the nearest depression in the waste of land. And the camels started heading towards the nearest depression in the sand, the nearest downside area in the sand. The reason presently became clear to Christopher as he gazed at the horizon. The camels had felt that there was a windstorm was nearby, so they headed towards they changed their direction towards the nearest depression in the waste of sand. And when Christopher noticed, he gazed at the horizon, he looked at the horizon, he came to know, he realized that what is the reason? The reason is actually the sandstorm. It was incredible. It was quite unbelievable. The dunes seemed to be on fire. The peaks were melting away. The dunes, they felt that the dunes, the high up areas in the sand, in the desert, it seemed that they were on the fire. Means they just got dead red. The peaks were melting away, and the whole horizon was changing shape. The whole horizon was just changing its shape. Then, as it started to get dark, I heard a sound like wind blowing through the leaves of a tree. And then it got dry and it got dark. It got so dark that it was just horrible. And Christopher heard the sounds of the wind, as if the wind is blowing through the dark leaves, through the dead leaves of a tree. His companions made signs for him to hide himself behind his camel. His companions asked him to hide himself behind the camel and cover his head. He did so, but the force of the storm when it struck was too great to be avoided. But he couldn't avoid the force of the storm. Even if he hid himself behind the camel and covered his face, his head, still he couldn't escape the force of the storm. Even with the camel's body as a shield, I could feel the impact of the wall of sand that came streaming along the earth. The wind found even the smallest opening in my clothes, and the sand felt like little needles. So this is the expression given by Christopher himself, that if the wind just passed through even the smallest openings of his clothes, and the wind was felt just like the small grains of sand were felt like little needles through his body. There was nothing he could do but crouch down, waiting for the storm to finish. He couldn't do anything except crouching down and waiting for the storm to finish, to end, to go. While the sand steadily piled up on top of him, and the sand had piled on the top of his head, he found himself recalling a true story, that just such a sandstorm many years earlier had completely buried a huge caravan of 1200 camels without leaving a trace of them. He just at that time, he just recalled, he came to remember one of the sandstorms, the story he had heard about a sandstorm which had buried a huge caravan of 1200 camels, and it didn't left even a trace of them. So he recalled that story. The present storm fortunately was less drastic, but fortunately the present storm which he was encountering, that was just less drastic. It was less dangerous and lasted only half an hour, and it lasted only for 30 minutes. But they all had 75 millimeters of sand completely covering them, and it did not need much imagination to understand how a party could easily be buried and suffocated. So but the amount of sand which was covering them, that was 75 millimeter, which is quite much. And through this covering, they could just have an idea how easily a sandstorm can bury or cover such a large caravan of 1200 camels. Kidal was the last town on his route before Timbuktu itself, but there were still over 450 kilometers of grim desert to be crossed. Though Kidal was the second last point of his destination, because the last destination, which was Timbuktu, that was coming right after Kidal, but still the distance was long. The uncovered distance was still long. It was 450 kilometers. This proved to be the loneliest and most arduous stage of the whole desert crossing. Now this, where they were, the region where they were passing by, that was proved to be the loneliest one and the most difficult, most complex or arduous or serious ones, serious stage for crossing the whole desert. The stress of desert travel had affected him physically. The stress which he had to encounter during his travel throughout the desert, that had affected him physically. His hand had become so cracked that he could hardly use his camera. He was unable to use his camera because his hand was damaged. To add to his troubles, he took his camel one day across a huge slab of rock on a slight incline. What increased his difficulty is that he had taken his camel to a huge slab of rock which was on a slight incline. Then he realized that it was covered with tiny stones. His camel fell heavily, knocking him off its back. So the camel fell heavily and he was knocked off the camel's back. Christopher was knocked off. He threw down on its back, and though it was not really injured, it was so shocked and frightened that he could not ride it for some time. But the camel was the camel was not seriously injured, but it was shocked. The camel was shocked and he wasn't able to have a ride. So Christopher had to wait for some time in order that the camel gets relaxed to give a ride again, but had to follow it on foot. And he had followed the camel with on foot. Another little incident served as a reminder that the desert has many ways of destroying its victims. Christopher was helping to gather stones to place in the fire for the kettle or pan to stand on. He picked up one large rock to find a 4-foot snake coiled under it. Another danger or risk he encountered is that he was gathering some stones to put in the fire so that he could place his kettle or pan on those stones. And when he picked one of the stones, he found a snake coiled under that stone. It uncoiled rapidly and struck, but he managed to jump back just in time to avoid the deadly fangs. And the snake had jumped to the snake rapidly uncoiled in order to bite him, but he was fortunately he escaped its bite. He escaped its bite. So he escaped the bite of that snake by jumping straight away. And the guide slave killed it with a stone. The guide slave, as he was with them, the slave killed it with a stone, indicating by gesture that it was a very poisonous specimen. And he told that this species of snake that was quite poisonous. A day later, he caught his first glimpse of Timbuktu. He had reached his goal at last, and his journey had taken him across 32 kilometers of desert. Finally, he reached Timbuktu, and he had reached his goal, but he had to travel 32 kilometers of desert in order to reach that goal. This was the end of the main journey, but it was by no means the end of his adventures. It was the end of his journey. Main journey was this, that he reached Timbuktu, but it wasn't his the end of his adventures. The stay in Timbuktu had enabled him to recover some of the weight he had lost in the desert. He had lost most of his weight during his travel in the desert, but reaching Timbuktu and staying over there, he had been able to recover some of his weight, and he was beginning to feel fit and well. Now he began to feel fit and well. He experienced a curious longing to see some more of the strange and mighty desert before leaving the country, perhaps for good. Now he still had the desire or curiosity to see some more area of the desert, and before leaving that country, a sudden decision was made. He sent a telegram to Professor Claude Bellangwernen in Tamanrasset. Hanji,